right wish for Lord Mayor of Liverpool, Councillor Roy Gladden.
Moving agreement to plan the session or the chairing of the meeting as a whole for the short period. I want to avoid the situation so the public can listen to the full debate, but of course that behaviour is entirely in your hands. It should also be a statement of the obvious that members should never identify members of the public or officers of the council. Let me be clear on one thing. The council will not be governed by comments on social media or with the greatest of respect to our colleagues in the press gallery or in the local media. This council makes decisions based on evidence, and so unsubstantiated and often anonymous comments or allegations made online are entirely irrelevant to this meeting and should not be referred to. Such comments should not be repeated here, and if they are, members place themselves individually at risk for defamation proceedings. Members should be aware that statements made in this chamber are not protected from legal action against them personally. This is not the House of Parliament where a statement can be made and be protected at law by absolute privilege. Within this chamber we have no such privilege. However, meeting my expectations as to conduct of the chamber should avoid any risk arising to any individual member. I also point out that a significant amount of online debate and discussion references to report prepared in 2018 about the companies and the council. I'm advised that the council's position is that it was not an official report of the council, nor was it ever adopted by the council. My position is therefore that this report should not be referred to as a council report. Finally, just saying that there's some procedural matters to allow the meeting to flow more quickly. In both meetings, I will take the moves and seconds of the motions and any amendments, and then we will move on to the general debate. Just for the people not to worry about whether they wish to speak to the original motion or the amendment. Any procedural motion should be moved between speeches, so if there's a point of order, etc., you do it between the speeches and not interfere with whoever speaking. Voting will be carried out by a show of hands and in accordance with Rule 25.1, except, of course, in a card vote. I'll finish my statement. We have 1 hour maximum for the extraordinary meeting, and no extension will therefore be granted. This will enable the number of people to actually participate who wish to do so. We will be live streaming this event, but we have had technical issues over the past few months. One of the main causes is the large volume of users during council meetings, which can cause the connection to the live stream to fail. Therefore, I would ask that where possible, all those in the chamber disconnect from the town hall Wi-Fi, and if you need to download any documents, please do so now. Thank you. Your worship, Steve?
I was just purely going to ask that I know my colleagues in the Liberal Party group and the independent group were interested in doing a card vote, so on the clarification that is allowable and the standing orders.
Steve, the card vote is always in the long position, but the clearly defined it again. And now it's being set aside. Hence, the reason I want to give as many people as possible, which will include the people putting amendments, seconding, speaking, and then, of course, voting will also take that up. So, if people take this into consideration when they're speaking themselves, that will give more people an opportunity to speak who wish to do so.
Thank you.
Is that okay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
If I can simply add that what we're trying to move away from is on every vote, counting every individual vote to speed matters up where there's a clear majority. But obviously, that's. The rights of members to card votes or individually recorded votes remain. Sorry. Members are required to declare any disclosable pecuniary interests or other registrable interests if they relate to items on this agenda. Members are also required to declare non-registrable interests, personal and prejudicial, if these relate to items on the agenda. If a member has a disclosable personal interest or an interest which is prejudicial, the member will need to leave the chamber during the consideration of the item. Are there any such declarations? No, Lord Mayor.
have a proposition motion by councillors Alfie Dinks, Anna Watry, Alan Gibbons, Sarah Moore, Alison Clark, Ron Lehan, Sam Dawes, and John Calvert. Before I ask the mover, just for the council, please note that there's been a factual correction to the amendment on the call. This is Appendix A. And it now reads, this council views with concern the content of the 2015, 2017, 2019, and this would be amendment, Hampton Road car park, and the usual ideas community interest company CIC, Taylor McCoy, report to memorandum. This was given to the mover as a second, and yes, for this to be approved. Okay? So then that's for the mover.
We need to speak to the original motion. Consequently, the amendments.
No, it wasn't.
It wasn't. We're asking to change the amendment.
I'm saying, well, that just read out was something that was asked to be put in because there was a couple of ways of the original motion that had been missed out. Is that understood now? As I was saying, it didn't have, it just had 2015, yeah. 2017, it did have Anfield Car Park, yeah. After that to be introduced.
Yeah.
So it's now been put in.
Okay.
That's all the four members here. So can I just ask for the mover? And to clarify, colleague, the mover has, I'm not going to start yet, has 5 minutes, the second grade. The paper removal amendments 5 and 3, and then we then wish to speak 3 minutes. So what we're trying to do is get as many as possible, so please help us out with this.
Thank you. Lord Mayor. Lord Mayor, the beautiful ideas company scandal paints a picture of mismanagement, misuse of public funds, conflicts of interest and cover-up and sleaze. Mayor Joanne Anderson's decision to launch a full investigation into the alleged fraud and corruption was a step in the right direction, but it must not be a means to a quick end, and we must not have a whitewash of this whole sad situation. The BICOP was set up to use money raised from the Super Anfield car parks, which is now being alleged was three car parks. The money from this was due to benefit from the company's activities, and the awards that were going to get benefit was my awards in Everton, Capsley awards and Anfield. These wards are amongst the most deprived in our city, and we know that over £100,000 was not being made available in those communities who desperately need it. Of the money that was distributed, as Liverpool Labour's own internal report makes clear, there were examples of appropriate investments, but many others raised questions, serious questions. The involvement of the three councillors, one councillor as a director and two others as advisers, mean the highest standard of openness, honesty and transparency should have been observed. But the way this company was run truly beggars belief. The three internal audit reports reveal that money was taken without number tickets, verification or an audit trail. There was a failure to ensure that the money went to good causes. Huge sums of money were doled out to organisations with close links to the company's directors and companies that were either not trading or barely staying afloat without proper due diligence. And we've seen today, or yesterday, of the report of the money going to Salford to benefit and to give loans to companies outside this city. There was major questions of the involvement of the three councillors' nepotism and cronyism. £20,000 was used to appoint the daughter of one of the councillors to the company.
Please. Be careful. I mean, it's
okay, but
just please withdraw that. We're not naming the councillors at all. Well,
I'm not naming councillors, no, I'm not naming any councillors.
I'm not trying to just say, okay, no, you haven't named them.
Okay,
just get to my sentence. Nepotism, cronyism is not language we do that with the next step.
Okay. The fifth known principle manner. Information should not be withheld from the public unless there is a clear, lawful reason for doing so. Yet, it took the intervention of the Information Commissioner's Office to make the internal audit report into the Beautiful Ideas Company come to light and open to public scrutiny. This was after four long years. We know that when internal audit looked into money held in one company's account, it could not be assessed because the password holder was never available. There was no signed declarations for audit review. Takings were not independently verified and reconciled to the number of vehicles in the car parks. One role of the audit committee is to review the assessment of fraud risks and potential harm to the council from fraud and corruption. Why was this not done openly and transparently? Why did it take years of effort by them, and I can't name the councillor, but the former councillor that tried to unravel this? And a journalist, ordinary citizens of this city and members of my group have took this and wrote it out. Sorry? Okay. Lord Mayor, more scandals keep appearing in our media. North Point Global, Chinatown, Vauxhall Road, Beetham Plaza and many more. People lost their life savings, their whole money gone because they trusted in these companies. The city should not be a playground for unaccountable property developers. Lord Mayor, I'll just try and finish this quickly.
Please sum up now, please.
Okay. Chair, we are not acting as judge or jury here, but when there is evidence of misuse of public funds, it is obvious, of course, that we should not be held, or this council should be held accountable for this. Thank you.
Difficult for Liverpool City Council. The Cabinet report has cast a shadow on its operations, as transparency in an election campaign, the proof of the pudding will be in the eating. This organisation has been anything but transparent about being here. For years there have been rumours and allegations culminating in third party reports, yet it took an information commissioner's officer intervention to bring the free internal audit reports into the open. Every penny lost to corruption, waste and mismanagement is a penny that should be spent on private public services. So the people we represent deserve answers about Beacon. They deserve to know why money intended for some of our most deprived communities did not materialise. They deserve to know why there was a lack of clear audit trail. They deserve to know why money appears to have been awarded to friends and relatives of companies' boards with a fair and open process, so that's a fair and open process. We will be shaking our responsibilities as elected members that we did not demand the most rigorous scrutiny of BECO and rural councillors in its functioning. That is why it is essential that there is an independent element in any investigation. It should not be conducted by officers employed by the council alone. Transparency has to be done and seen to be done. This is what our fraud and anti-corruption strategy demands. The council must have a strong and recognised anti-fraud culture, one where the council's leaders, both elected and employed, uphold the high standards of conduct both in their duties and in their personal financial dealings. We need to vote for transparency, vote for independent element in the investigation, and if you have nothing to hide, then prove it.
So people can speak then to either the main motion or the amendments themselves. So we put the first is by Councillor Andrew Matheson.
Some of the money from a Liverpool organisation council's interacted with the company which gives cause for concern. Now, anyone who's had small businesses, and I have a long time ago now, knows that many new small businesses fail. But as far as I can see from the reports that have been issued, what makes a Beautiful Ideas company absolutely unique is that every company they put equity, loan, or any other sort of finance into seems to have failed. They seem to have, from the available information that I've seen, 100% track record of failure, whilst most people would be going for 50% track record of failure because you accept the risk when you want to help new community-based businesses. How did that happen? Where was the supervision? Were there people within the council as officers who could have stepped in and looked at the business plans and things like that that were being presented? Could we have brought in outside expertise for that matter? Perhaps we could, but clearly we didn't. We put money into a company in various forms and then basically left them to it. And what the council has looked at is the legal propriety of that. How we gave the money, was it being stolen, what were the procedures within the council. But those do not address the overall issues of the consistent failure of this company. And that is something else we must learn. My Lord Mayor, all of us want to help new small social enterprises. All of us want to help community interest companies. It's a very important part of the Mayor's triple lock, and I certainly support those aims. But it's no good just giving money to a company. When I act as an advisor to small businesses, I spent a considerable amount of my time trying to stop people going into business because it was clear that they didn't have a chance. Yeah, I'll close now, my Lord Mayor. Yeah, it's quite clear they didn't have a chance. So there are still issues to look at, which is why we hope we'll support our amendment, because that should be something everyone wants. But then I'll ask you to vote against the Labour amendment, because it doesn't deal with some of the big issues which still remain.
Thank you. I'm trying to move before, but that was again all of us, so you're actually eating in to the sound that people have got to. When you see the green to come on, that gives you 30 seconds, so finish. But yeah, I like it to not. Right, is that seconded?
Yes, Lord Mayor. Thank you. Thank you, Lord Mayor. We welcome this debate as the Beautiful Ideas Company is something which my party first raised questions about many years ago. And I congratulate those who continue to campaign on this issue, many of whom are here today in the public gallery, for their tenacity resulting in this extraordinary meeting and the call for a full and rigorous inquiry into the company and its relationship to the Liverpool City Council. But let's be clear, Lord Mayor, this is seen by many as just another example of how Labour in power cannot be trusted with taxpayers' money. Yet another so-called community interest company set up whose activities have been continually questioned and leave more than just a sour taste in the mouths of council taxpayers. After 12 years of mismanagement, no one on that side of the chamber, not even the new leader-elect, can be proud of this council record. And that's because every single one of you is complicit, and the people of Liverpool would appreciate just a little bit of remorse for what's gone on in our city for more than a decade. But after seeing how you treat each other, I guess we shouldn't be too surprised by the contempt in which you hold the people we serve. It's also yet another example, Lord Mayor, of how poor scrutiny has been under this mayoral system. And let us hope that the new system of governance next May will ensure similar situations do not happen in the future. But we won't be holding our breath. If you're really serious about openness and transparency, you'll support the Liberal Democrat amendments, which request that a report be prepared which outlines how both freedom of information requests and councillors' right to know requests are handled. Lord Mayor, this goes to the heart of the problem, and on that note, and in this new spirit of openness and transparency, perhaps the city solicitor could update us on an issue where we know both FOI and Councillor Wright's no requests have been submitted. Back in January, the Liverpool Echo reported that a number of Labour councillors were allegedly being let off paying fines, proving...
Councillor, please, we said we'd stick to the motion.
Okay.
Nothing at all to do with the motion.
So
please, no.
Okay.
Move on.
Okay. It was at the time, 2015, which is the same time that the Beautiful Ideas Company was set up. It perhaps gives people an indication of the culture that was in the council at the time. And it surely is all right to know, as councillors, who those councillors were who were involved in that parking issue.
No, councillor, that's it. Look, sit down. Sit down, please. Councillor, sit down. Sit down, please.
Wow.
Your last once, is it the second time? No, no, I told you. The things we're talking about have nothing to do with the motion. I read out at the very beginning about what we're going to stick to. If you want to move on with yourself, you can send letters in to the Chief Executive or the City Solicitor on those questions. That's got nothing to do with this motion. Okay, thank you. Next.
Thank you, Lord Mayor.
We have a second amendment. Councillor Bennett.
Just before I move the motion, we're not opposed to the motion that comes from that comes from Councillor Kent, but we can't at this stage accept as it becomes an addition to the main motion, but we're not opposed to what you say in that amendment. Lord Mayor, can I move the amendment standing in my name, please, and I defer to the Mayor to make a statement.
Well, can I just ask the City Solicitor for some advice on what's just been said, because I didn't understand it. We've written this amendment so it is to be accepted. Are there any circumstances? And I see no reason why it couldn't be incorporated into but at the end of the amended motion from Councillor Bennett.
Just unfortunately, as it stands, it's an addition to the main motion, but we would be willing to accept that amendment to our amendment.
That's a question, it'll be answered. Hang on.
Yeah, sure. I thought I'd be answered.
No. I'm making sure you get a legal position.
My legal position is I think you have been answered. And we can obviously, any matter that's in a motion, we can develop outside of this meeting if there is content among all groups.
Okay, Richard?
Major one?
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I'm not aware of the internal water performance into the Anfield car parks until a week or so before the ICO ruling. And after reading the reports, it was clear, particularly in relation to the Beautiful Awards, that at the very minimum, it was poor practice in terms of financial record keeping. I also requested whether any codes of conduct or ruling principles have been breached. And I made a statement to the Echo we were pushing. Response, and I contacted the City Solicitor and asked could they look into the audit reports of 2015, 17 and 19, identifying any historical issues of poor practice, and identifying whether any council involved had broken code of conduct. As well as the internal audit report published in October, following the decision from the Information Commissioner, members will be aware of a further report from the Beautiful Ideas Company published in 2018. I'd like to clarify that this report is not an official Liverpool City Council report. It was neither written nor commissioned by any council officer and has no formal standard in the council. And that's the source of a lot of misinformation around looking into the car park. I wrote to the council's monitoring officer, I submitted all the audit reports and asked him to look into the process. I also included review of procedural errors so that the council processes could be amended and approved to mitigate against this ever happening again. The investigation I asked for is now concluded and no further action will be taken due to a lack of evidence in four cases and one case is still being assessed. And I'll ask the City Solicitor to come back to me to explain this decision making there. I can also confirm that the audit reports were shared with the police in 2015 and 2016. terms of record keeping, there has clearly been poor practice in the council in terms of the initial beautiful law setup, not to be confused with Vika. And when I've asked the solicitor to confirm to me how this will happen again, I've been told the following steps. The council have ensured that sufficient governance, internal control measures, policies and procedures are in place to ensure that such future relationships are appropriately monitored and that any nominated representatives from the council are fully aware of the provision of specific training of their responsibilities, the nature of the role appointed to, and any obligations that they have. The council will ensure that there's sufficient targets and KPI arrangements in place in any operational agreements, contracts, license or license agreements. The council will ensure there's sufficient obligations and clauses in any agreements between the council and third parties, including community organisations. And when the board nor investing money, the council will ensure the following appropriate legal advice and any agreements between councils and third parties take into account any specific legal or regulatory obligations related to the assets of relevant organisations, including community interest companies. In the future, the council will have an option of managing the assets in-house or seek competitive offers from external management companies, potentially on a profit-sharing basis, to incentivise effective and good management. And more strategically, we have a council-wide approval plan and directory plans, which are action solutions which can also be referenced. The council has also put in place wide governance and internal control measures on many aspects of the work that it delivers. I have exhausted the avenues available to me and followed due process, and if anyone has any evidence on any individual acts of wrongdoing, then they need to either submit it to the council with further evidence, or if they believe a criminal act has taken place, then they should report it to the police. When elected as mayor, I pledge to increase the council's commitment to transparency, accountability, scrutiny, and I stand by this. I stood for mayor because I care deeply about the city, and whilst I remain committed to rectifying the mistakes of wrongdoing from years gone by, many years gone by, I am confident this council is in a very different place today.
Thank you, Mayor.
I ask the city solicitor to explain his decision making and the process as well, please.
Starting before the next one.
In respect of the code of conduct complaint, self-evidently, I'm not going to refer to individual complaints, but I think the fundamental issue is one that the mayor has just touched on, which is to make any complaints or found any criminal allegation, you need evidence as opposed to an allegation or an assertion that is unsubstantiated on receipt, and that evidence needs to relate to the individual about which the complaint is made. And then thirdly, it needs to demonstrate that there has been breach of the code of conduct. If that standard is reached, then under the code of conduct, an investigation is likely to take place. In these cases, that standard was not reached, and in particular, and the mayor has made her plea to people who have evidence to bring that forward, and I repeat that plea. We will look as a council into any allegation of misconduct or other activity, and if necessary, report that to the police. But if we do not receive those allegations, then our hands are tied.
Thank you. Councillor Bennett, do you have a second to your... Call me. You say you're right, yes. Can please then, those indicate you wish to speak? Make sure we get from numbers. Mr. Bradford.
Is there anybody else who wishes to speak on this matter? Well, I know if we've got time, then after people have spoken, then I'll bring it in as a vote. So, as the first hand that went up was Councillor Bradshaw. Please leave a few minutes, please.
Thank you, my lord. Lots of allegations have been made, but the fundamentals, I think, are absolutely on threefold quite bloody. And I've not heard anything that would convince me that the critical issues have actually been addressed. Firstly, I took some time, and I'm grateful for this assistance and guidance. I read the ICO report. I am incredibly disheartened that the public interest was upheld by the intervention of the Information Commissioner's Office rather than our own internal advice. And I ask everybody who has not read that report to do so, because that strikes at the issue that I think Matt's called a miss. And that is, it's good enough to criticise councillors for not doing their job, but if councillors are not given all the information by the officers who should protect their knowledge, then how can they do their job properly? I rest that issue. That is my issue one, and is why I fundamentally object to the Labour Party amendment. To actually say that we shouldn't give credit to the ICO office for bringing this whole report to our attention is to deny the facts. Secondly, I actually would give credit to Councillor Kent's speech, I think that was first class, and I would support his amendment as an addendum to whatever way the debate comes out. There is only one slight differentiation. It is not whether beautiful ideas gave money to the benefit of the residents in Liverpool. That is not what was established. And I remember the debates. When the debate, I think Councillor Mombie spoke to the debates when we first established the company and gave some very articulate views why it should be attended. The debate was clearly the beneficiaries would be the residents of Everton, Anfield and Cantwell, not you, Brooke. And I remember that, and that room. And so if I'm wrong, I'd be glad to accept that. But that's what my understanding was from the debate.